What a privilege it is to have you with Pam and me by the fireside at this very special time of year. Oh my goodness, Pam, do you like Christmas?
I do. I like, I leave the lights on. I like lights a lot.
It's such a, look, it's such a special time of year, and we're so glad to be with you. And you know what? You can't have a Christmas Eve, Christmas Day special without singing some beautiful Christmas carols. And what a wonderful celebration to put Jesus first and make it all about joy to the Savior, joy to the Lord, and we can pronounce joy to the world. So sing along with us, joy to the world.
Don't you just love the true hope of Christmas? We're so glad that we're together today. This is a really special time.
You know, for me, Pam, I often, you know, I love Christmas, but you and I, it hasn't always been easy at Christmas. I think the first 10, 11 years of our marriage, we were always on the road, always away from home at Christmas. And sometimes it was a little bit lonely and just the desire to be at home at Christmas. I remember our first Christmas at home was when you had that emergency surgery and we were kind of forced to be at home. But man, there we were Christmas Day having peas on toast, cream peas on toast.
Lentil soup, green pea soup. That's right. But we were so thankful. It's amazing, you know, in times like this, just to be thankful. Yeah. You know, hope comes from being thankful. You know, and just think of some things to be thankful for this Christmas Day.
You know what? God said that He would never leave you, never forsake you. You're so important. I mean, more than anything, I just want you to get the message at this special time of year that you're so loved by God. God loves you. No matter where you're at, no matter what you're going through, no matter how alone you feel or how surrounded by family you feel, God loves you. He sees you. He loves you. And I just want you to meditate on that as Stephanie leads us in this beautiful carol, Silent Night. You know, it really was a holy night, a miraculous night, you know, full of a beautiful cast of characters. You got Joseph, Mary, the shepherds, the angels, you got wise men from the east. So let me set the stage here before we start reading the famous account in Luke chapter 2, which I love this story. We get to, you know, one of your favorite lines, the heavenly knighthood.
Heavenly knighthood. You love reading
about that. But we read in Luke 1 that an angel by the name of Gabriel visits Mary, the virgin, who's betrothed to Joseph, right? And she's basically, he walks her over and says, "You're highly favored. You're blessed, Mary." And she says, "I am." And he goes, "You are." And he says, "God has chosen you to carry His only begotten Son, Jesus." And she's like, "Well, how's this going to be? I've never known a man. I'm a virgin." And he says, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will be with child." And you know, the wonderful response of this young virgin, she says to the angel Gabriel, she says, "According to the words, the Lord's word, be it unto me." Isn't that beautiful? Like, just,
I love that.
The audacious faith, the courageous faith to say such a thing, you know, in that state. And
you know, I think the word of God is speaking to us all the time, and we need to say, stand up and take courage and say, Okay, God, according to your word, be it unto me. In Luke 1:37, it says, for nothing shall be impossible. And that's what that little young Mary said. You know, okay, nothing's going to be impossible.
She says, be it unto me according to your word, God.
Yeah.
I love that. The Blessed Virgin welcomed God, not only into her life, but, you know, thank God for her faith and her courageousness, because she welcomed God into the world for all of us. Right?
Yeah. You know, when you make your choices, when we make choices to receive God's goodness, it doesn't just affect you. If you don't take courage to receive God's goodness, it affects those all around you, the people you love. So take courage today, not only for yourself, but those that you love around you.
So get the kids all gathered up around the TV or around your computer, whatever, and let's read together the real story of Christmas, the genius of God, that He would be God incarnate, God in the flesh, showing up here on earth to save us. So gather everyone around and let's read this story together. Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 20. And Pam, you start it off.
In those days, it occurred that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the whole Roman Empire should be registered.
This was the first enrollment, and it was made by Quirinius, who was governor of Syria.
And all the people were going to be registered, each to his own city or town.
And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the town of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David,
to be enrolled with Mary, his espoused wife, who was about to become a mother.
And while they were there, the time came for her delivery.
And she gave birth to her son, her firstborn, and she wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for him in the inn.
And in that vicinity, there were shepherds living out under the open sky in the field, watching in shifts over their flock by night.
And behold, an angel of the Lord stood by them, and the glory of the Lord flashed and shone all about them, and they were terribly frightened.
But the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of a great joy, which will come to all the people.
For to you is born this day in the town of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord.
And this will be a sign for you, by which you will recognize him. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger.
And then suddenly there appeared with an angel an army of the troops of heaven, a heavenly knighthood, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest,
and on earth peace among men with whom he is well pleased.
And when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, let's go over to Bethlehem and let's see that thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us.
So they went in haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger.
And when they saw it, they made known what had been told them concerning the child.
And all who heard it were astounded and marveled at what the shepherds told them.
But Mary was keeping this within herself, all these things, weighing and pondering them in her own heart.
And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, just as it had been told them. Pam, what an awesome story. It's the Christmas story. It's the real story. And you get that heavenly knighthood in there, right? They're all up there beating their shields and they're saying, glory to God in the highest. Oh my goodness, it doesn't get more beautiful than that. It's just, you know, it's what I love though is when you get children involved with the Christmas story and just some of the wild things that kids hear and say and things that just happened traditionally through the years. There was a class of six-year-olds singing the Hark the Herald Angels Sing at this Christmas concert. And the line, God and sinners reconciled. You know how like sometimes a six-year-old hearing that, you probably could twist it, right? So there was this little, it was a little bit tricky for these grade oneers. And a little boy with a voice that completely drowned out all the rest of the choir, he happily belted out, God and sinners dressed in style. There was another group of kids and they were telling the Christmas story. And when it came to the part about the wise men bringing baby Jesus gifts, the one little guy said, and they brought baby Jesus stuffed animals, diapers, and fancy sneakers. I was reading, you know, what kids say, and somebody asked what the wise men brought to Jesus. And one kid said, well, gold and some other crazy thing. And he goes, but, you know, he would have rather had like a wrestling toy or something like that. You know, kids, I love how they project on the Christmas story what really mattered. But, you know, the wonderful thing about the Christmas story is that it's not about the North Pole or Santa or reindeer, of course, and all the interpretations that kids and grown-ups have kind of twisted over the years about the Bethlehem story. But in these challenging times, the Christmas story really is authentically about God getting His joy to us, His beautiful joy into our life. You know, one of the greatest parts, Pam, of the Christmas story is the gift. You know, Christmas really is about gifts, the gift, which is Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, and receiving that gift. And one of the most important parts of this celebration is you receiving the gift from God the Father of Jesus, the only begotten Son of God. And I just want to encourage you to do that right now. I just want you to, in this place and time in history, to receive what really matters to your future, to your life, to your family, to your forever. That's Jesus. Jesus is, as they say, the reason for the season, but Jesus is the reason for your life, for you going forward. He is your hope. He is, like I like how Pam puts it, your guiding compass. He is that light that lights the way into your future. And so you can do that right now by just praying this simple prayer. Just say, Dear Lord Jesus, I know that you're the reason for Christmas. God sent you. You are the only begotten Son, born of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Come into my heart. Forgive me of all my sins. I know you died on the cross for me. God, raise you again from the grave. Live in my life. Be the King of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Right now, you're a child of God. That means you get the privilege of having communion with us. Communion is such a special time. Even as we sing this next song, Pam's going to lead us in Emmanuel, O Come, Emmanuel, beautiful carol. But even as that song's being played, why don't you get just a little piece of bread or cracker and a little bit of grape juice and just join us as we have a time of communion, because you're a child of God now. And what a wonderful time at Christmas to have communion together as we celebrate God's precious gift, His only begotten Son, Jesus.
Bring us light. Rejoice, rejoice.
Remember the angels we just read, the angels, the heavenly knighthood shouted and declared, "Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill to men." Do you want that peace? You know what? The body of Jesus, that's what the bread represents, and the cup represents the blood of Jesus. And Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and that's what we celebrate right now. When we have communion, we communicate to God how that we accept and are thankful for His body and the blood of Christ that sets us free and gives us what the angels shouted, "Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill to men and women and boys and girls." That is such a beautiful Christmas gift, to know that we can go into the future with God's peace in our life. So right now, precious Heavenly Father, we receive this bread that represents your Son's body. We receive the finished work that He performed for us at the cross, in Jesus' precious name. And in the same way, Lord Jesus, we affectionately call you to remembrance as we receive the cup right now that 1 Corinthians 11 talks about, the cup that represents your shed blood, why you came to earth with God's pure blood in your veins to shed your blood and reverse the curse for us, that we might have the blessing, the Christmas blessing, 365 days of the year. Praise God. To the glory of Jesus, the King of Kings, we receive the cup. Oh, that's so good. That's so good. You know what? As a benediction today, I'd like to leave you with a song. A song just that says that, can we have Christmas all year long, and invites Jesus to stay in our home, in our family, in our life. Listen to this song, and just if you get it, sing along. Can we have Christmas all year long, and ask Jesus to stay? God bless you in this Christmas season.
He had on his new pajamas, you know, the red ones with the feet. And it's now four-year tradition we have each Christmas Eve. Reached out those little hands toward me when I called him, "Hey, you sleepyhead." Then he snuggled tight against my shoulder when I carried him off to bed. Then gently I kissed him and whispered goodnight. Then I heard Daddy as he turned out the light. He said, "Can we have Christmas all the year long? Tell stories of Jesus and sing all his songs. Something is special in our home today. Can we ask Jesus to stay?" First I had to just smile to myself, such a childish request. Then he started to list one by one all of the things that he liked the best. He said, "Daddy, you found your old Bible, read about the shepherds, the kings, and a star. Something nice you said to Mommy." Well, she almost cried. But then you kissed her real hard. Now I like the toys, but it's not what I mean. Oh, can we keep this love after we take down the tree? Can we have Christmas all the year long? Tell stories of Jesus and sing all his songs. Something is special in our home today. Can we ask Jesus to stay? I closed the door and stepped into the hall. My wife was standing there, my wife had heard it all. And my heart was pounding, my child made me understand that my family needed more than just another tradition. She said, can we have Christmas all the year long? Tell stories of Jesus and sing all his songs. Cause something is special in our home today. Can we ask Jesus? Let's ask Jesus. Can we ask Jesus to stay? Oh, Jesus, would you stay?